As mechanically as an automaton, I began to reply. As I heard once more the alien and unreal tones of my own voice, I became convinced that it was someone else who spoke, and in another world. I sat and listened. Still the voice kept speaking. Now, for the first time, I experienced the vast change which Hashish makes in all measurements of time. The first word of the reply occupied a period sufficient for the action of a drama. The last left me in complete ignorance of any point far enough back in the past to date the commencement of the sentence. Its enunciation might have occupied years. I was not in the same life which had held me when I heard it begun. And now, with time, space expanded also. At my friend's house, one particular armchair was always reserved for me. I was sitting in it at a distance of hardly 3 feet from the center table around which the members of the family were grouped. Rapidly, that distance widened. The whole atmosphere seemed ductile and spun endlessly out into great spaces surrounding me on every side. We were in a vast hall of which my friends and I occupied opposite extremities. The ceiling and the walls ran upward with a gliding motion as if vivified by a sudden force of resistless growth. Oh, I could not bear it. I should soon be left alone in the midst of an infinity of space. And now more and more, every moment increased the conviction that I was watched. Know then, as I learned afterwards, that suspicion of all earthly things and persons was the characteristic of the Hashish delirium. In the midst of my complicated hallucination, I could perceive that I had a dual existence. One portion of me was whirled unresistingly along the track of this tremendous experience. The other sat looking down from a height upon its double, observing, reasoning, and serenely weighing all the phenomena. This calmer being suffered with the other by sympathy, but did not lose its self-possession. Presently it warned me that I must go home, lest the growing effect of the hashish should incite me to some act which might frighten my friends. I acknowledged the force of this remark very much as if it had been made by another person, and rose to take my leave. I advanced toward the center table. With every step, its distance increased. I nerved myself as for a long pedestrian journey. Still, the lights, the faces, the furniture receded. At last, almost unconsciously, I reached them. It would be tedious to attempt to convey the idea of the time which my leave-taking consumed, and the attempt, at least with all minds that have not passed through the same experience, it would be as impossible as tedious. At last, however, I was in the street. Beyond me, the view stretched endlessly away. It was an unconverging vista whose nearest lamps seemed separated from me by leagues. I was doomed to pass through a merciless stretch of space, a soul just disenthralled, setting out for his flight beyond the furthest visible star, could not be more overwhelmed with his newly acquired conception of the sublimity of distance than I was at that moment. Solemnly, I began my infinite journey. Before long, I walked in entire unconsciousness of all around me. I dwelt in a marvelous inner world. I existed by turns in different places and various states of being. Now I swept my gondola through the moonlit lagoons of Venice. Now alp on alp towered above my view, and the glory of the coming sun flashed purple light upon the topmost icy pinnacle. Now, in the primeval silence of some unexplored tropical forest, I spread my feathery leaves, a giant fern, and swayed and nodded in the spice gales over a river whose waves at once sent up clouds of music and perfume. My soul changed to a vegetable essence, thrilled with a strange and unimaginable ecstasy. The palace of Al-Harun could not have brought me back to humanity. I will not detail all the transmutations of that walk. Ever and anon I returned from my dreams into consciousness as some well-known house seemed to leap out into my path, awakening me with a shock. The whole way homeward was a series of such awakenings and relapses into abstraction and delirium until I reached the corner of the street in which I lived. Here, a new phenomenon manifested itself. I had just awakened for perhaps the 20th time, and my eyes were wide open. I recognized all surrounding objects and began calculating the distance home. Suddenly, out of a blank wall at my side, a muffled figure stepped into the path before me. His hair, white as snow, hung in tangled elf locks on his shoulders, where he carried also a heavy burden, like unto the well-filled sack of sins which Bunyan places on the back of his pilgrim. Not liking his manner, I stepped aside, intending to pass around him and go on my way. This change of our relative position allowed the blaze of a neighboring streetlight to fall full on his face, which had hitherto been totally obscured. Horror unspeakable! I shall never, till the day I die, forget that face. Every lineament was stamped with the records of a life black with damning crime. It glared upon me with a ferocious wickedness and a stony despair which only he may feel who is entering on the retribution of the unpardonable sin. He might have sat to a demon painter as the ideal of Shelley's Cenci. I seemed to grow blasphemous in looking at him, and, in an agony of fear, began to run away. He detained me with a bony hand which pierced my wrist like talons, and slowly, taking down the burden from his own shoulders, laid it upon mine. I threw it off and pushed him away. Silently he returned and restored the weight. Again I repulsed him, this time crying out, "Man, what do you mean?"
"What do you mean?"
In a voice which impressed me with the sense of wickedness as his face had done, he replied,
You shall bear my burden
with me. And a third time laid it on my shoulders. For the last time I hurled it aside and, with all my force, dashed him from me. He reeled backward and fell, and before he could recover his disadvantage, I had put a long distance between us. Through the excitement of my struggle with this phantasm, the effects of the hashish had increased mightily. I was bursting with an uncontrollable life. I strode with the fuse of a giant. Hotter and faster came my breath. I seemed to pant like some tremendous engine. An electric energy whirled me resistlessly onward. I feared for myself lest it should burst its fleshy walls and glance on, leave a wrecked framework behind it. At last, I entered my own house. During my absence, a family connection had arrived from abroad and stood ready to receive my greeting. Partly restored to consciousness by the naturalness of home faces and the powerful light of a chandelier which shed its blaze through the room, I saw the necessity of vigilance against betraying my condition, and, with an intense effort suppressing all I felt, I approached my friend and said all that is usual on such occasions. Yet, recent as I was from my conflict with the supernatural, I cast a stealthy look about me that I might learn from the faces of others if, after all, I was shaking hands with a phantom and making inquiries about the health of a family of hallucinations. Growing assured as I perceived no symptoms of astonishment, I finished the salutation and sat down. It soon required all